Okay, the last lecture was about the evidence for evolution, and I told you that there's lots of it. Now let's actually take a look at the mechanism of evolution, and this is the mechanism that Charles Darwin proposed. Now it turns out that is not the only mechanism, but that is a mechanism for evolution. And so when it comes to natural selection, one of the things that you always have to remember that is that these things that go into natural selection, these processes, are processes we can observe, we can evaluate, we can account for, and these are not in any way, shape, or form controversial. The first one of these is a condition that is called overproduction. And we see a lot of this in nature. It turns out that all species produce more offspring in a generation than it takes to replace the parents. Now, what does that mean? If you are considering sexual reproduction, you know that it takes two individuals, right? It takes a male and a female. And if they produce offspring, as long as they produce two, then they would replace themselves, right? That's two for two, kind of. But in all species, over the reproductive life of these individuals, they would tend to produce more offspring, or they certainly can produce more offspring, in some cases a lot more. Take two toads. If you have a female toad and a male toad and they go out and reproduce, she can lay up to 40,000 eggs. Now, out of those 40,000 eggs, you're going to get potentially 40,000 tadpoles. You're probably not going to get 40,000, but you're going to get a substantial number that's much greater than the parents themselves. So you have overproduction. Even if you go with species that tend to be slow breeding, meaning that the generation time is long, or perhaps the gestation period is long, such as elephants or whales, you'll find that over a reproductive lifetime, they still overproduce, meaning they produce more individuals than the two parents that are involved. And so this, as a consequence, leads for a struggle for existence. Now, with the 40,000 potential tadpoles, it's pretty clear if they're all in the same pond or in the same puddle or wherever, you would realize very quickly that there are limited resources in that puddle, and therefore those that somehow perform better in obtaining nutrients and obtaining food would be the ones that have a greater chance to survive into becoming a mature toad. Not 40,000. Some of them are going to die. And this is natural selection. Natural selection is not stating that somebody comes along and picks which of these tadpoles are going to survive. It is just the environment and the circumstances in that environment that eventually dictate who's going to survive. So this is one of the key conditions for natural selection. The second condition, which is equally as innocuous and very obvious, is that there is individual variation in nature. Not everybody is the same. And because all of the individuals in the population have different characteristics, sometimes only slightly different characteristics, we therefore can say that this individual variation contributes to that struggle. If everybody were the same, exactly the same, then this struggle for existence would simply be a game of chance, right? Because, you know, everybody has a 50-50 chance of winning, everybody is just as strong as everybody else, and so the only reason why somebody might win over somebody else is because perhaps they stumble during the fight, or perhaps because wrong place, wrong time. It would be a game of chance and have nothing to do with inheritance or the characteristics that the individual organism has. But because everybody is a little bit different, therefore they react a little bit differently to situations in their environment, and that is the key for producing the next generation, because those that are slightly better equipped to deal with the environment, those that are slightly better in that struggle for existence, are going to be able to pass on their features, their characteristics, their genetic material to the next generation. And that's what makes this whole process shift from one generation to the next. It's because all of this is heritable. So those are the two main conditions. Struggle for existence because of overproduction, and it happens in all organisms we see, and some level of genetic variation in these organisms. As a consequence, you're going to end up with something we refer to as differential reproductive success. And this differential is what makes one individual or one group of individuals a little bit better than the next. And that's what we call natural selection. It's that slight difference, not even a huge difference, but over a long period of time, you'll end up that these small differences incrementally shift that population. And so those individuals that are best suited for their environment are the ones that can leave more fertile offspring. Now, when we call this in terms of the genetic material, then we can say that the genes of those individuals that are successful are selected for. And those that somehow aren't as good would be selected against. And so clearly, if somebody has, let's say, a genetic disorder, which is going to make survival more difficult for them, or perhaps finding a mate more difficult for them, then ultimately their genetic material may be selected against. Not necessarily selected against in an absolute measure, not like they can't reproduce at all, but perhaps they can reproduce with less frequency, or perhaps their offspring are going to be slightly less able to deal with the environment. And so over generation time, you'll find that these things sort themselves out. And that's why natural selection takes a lot longer than artificial selection. Artificial selection means that every time we see a feature we like, we as humans can pick that feature. We don't wait for whether that feature is actually better or worse or what. Our environment, in that case, is what we like. And that's what we can deal with in artificial selection. So these two processes are identical. The only difference is who intervenes. In artificial selection, it would be the human who intervenes. In natural selection, essentially nobody intervenes. It's just the environment. So one of the questions people tend to ask is, if this argument were true, then should we not see natural selection in action right now? Should we not be able to observe it all the time, essentially? There should be lots and lots of good examples. And some people have said, well, there aren't any examples because it's such a long process. And that's actually not true. You just have to know where to look. And yes, you do have to sometimes be a little bit patient because it does take a little while for some of these trends to become established, but some of them are so obvious. Pesticide resistance in insects, for example, is extremely obvious. If you or any of your relatives are involved in farming, you probably know about this, because if you spray a particular type of pesticide one growing season, then the rules basically say don't spray the same pesticide the next season because it might be less effective. There might be some of these insects that you're trying to kill that actually have the resistance, and if they are the only ones left over, then next season they and their offspring are going to be the ones still present. So don't hit them with the same pesticide because it's not going to be effective again. As a consequence, we have to rotate pesticides, and that's now the measure of how we can keep insects off our crops. Secondly, for those of you who are thinking of going into the health professions, development of antibiotic resistant bacteria is something that has come up and is something that's going to be with us for an extended period of time. And the reason why there is antibiotic resistance is because we have used antibiotics for so long and so frequently that eventually, just by chance, we have found some bacteria that happen to be resistant to the drug we administered. And in most cases, those types of bacteria will become resident in hospitals because that is where often we administer these bacteria, and where we administer them essentially indiscriminately. Anybody who goes to the hospital, one of the worst things that you could get in the hospital is an infection from the hospital. And so, of course, hospitals are trying to avoid that at any cost. and they will tend to give their patients broad-spectrum antibiotics no matter whether they really need it or not. So you may come into the hospital without any infection, but you will still be given an antibiotic. And so some of the bacteria that you normally carry are going to be exposed to that antibiotic, even though normally they should not be exposed. And so it increases the opportunity for us to find the one strain that may be resistant. And over the last 60 years or so, since we've been using antibiotics very widely, we have been able to find a variety of resistant bacteria, and some are now resistant to more than one type of antibiotic. And so this is going to be a challenge. But there are also examples that perhaps take a little bit longer to establish themselves so that you can immediately tell. But if you do some measurements, you can actually figure this out. The example I present here is horn length in lizards. This is almost a local example. Many of you know what these things are. These are also known as horny toads, but they're certainly not toads. They're actually lizards. And as you can see, they have in the back of their head, they have these little horns. Now, they have several levels of horns. Obviously, there's these ones, these long horns, but there's also several shorter horns. And what they would do as a defense is they can arch their head backwards, and if something grabs them here, they arch backward, and the predatory bird would therefore get a puncture wound, right? That's basically what happens. Or, if the bird perhaps doesn't grab them there, but maybe grabs them on the arm, then they can slash sideways, and so they can certainly hurt the bird that way. So this is a defensive mechanism. The behavior of moving the head is defensive, and the reason why it works is because they have these spines. Now, of course, if you didn't have these spines, the argument goes, why would you even rear up your head? Because you're not going to do anything with that. And so it's a behavior that supports the defensive structure. Now, if you do end up getting caught, then this could be the end result. These shrikes will kill the lizards, they will eat it, and they will actually do so by impaling it on a thorn or sometimes a barbed wire fence. And so when you walk along some of these areas where there's lots of thorns or barbed wire fences in parts of Arizona and New Mexico, you'll find that they have a variety of these lizards impaled on them. And that's a good thing for the researchers, because what you can do as a researcher is you can collect these, and you can then measure the length of these horns, and you can measure the length of these horns, and try and figure out whether the length of these horns has anything to do with whether the lizard becomes impaled or not. So here is the result. If you think about this as an experiment, as a prediction, then you would say, I assume that if you have longer horns, then the birds could get hurt more, perhaps, and as a consequence, the longer horn would allow you to survive. Right? That's the kind of thing you might predict, because it's a more successful strategy to have better weapons. Now, what you do then is you measure the horns of these lizards, take a bunch of live ones and measure their horns, and take a bunch of dead ones. And of course, amongst the live ones, there are some lizards that are going to be dead soon, right? Clearly. But amongst the dead ones, there are none that are going to be alive again. So that's sort of an absolute thing there. The dead ones are going to give you basically an average of what you know doesn't work, whereas the live ones include the ones that won't work and the ones that do work. So you have to take that into account. But when you do this, you can show that there is a difference. If you look at the different horns, the side horns, those are the longer ones, you can see that there is a difference here. This is the difference. Not a big difference. There is the difference here also. Not a big difference. In fact, if you look at the numbers, it's about 10%. 10% in this case means it's the difference between life and death for some of these lizards. Now, not all the lizards with slightly smaller horns are going to be eaten, and some of the ones with slightly longer horns are also going to be eaten. That's why we say that nature doesn't pick and choose. It doesn't sort of pick all the ones with slightly longer horns and say, hey, you guys are okay. It's just a law of averages. But you can tell here clearly that 10% makes the difference. And it's that little, tiny, incremental difference that is predicted to eventually create lizards with slightly longer horns. So over the years, when people do this kind of experiment again, perhaps in a decade, they would expect that if they go back to the same area, take the same measurements, they would think that the difference is perhaps a little bit more, and perhaps the ones with the longer horns have slightly longer horns again. So that's how natural selection works.